I don't think I'm growing these right. Actually, I really don't know what I'm doing here. These are my daikon radishes. I'm growing them for the first time, and I really have no idea what I'm doing. I know how to grow regular radishes, the French breakfast ones, but this is the first time I'm growing these. Somebody got me these seeds and wanted me to grow these, so I thought, why the heck not? So I planted them in here. Now, from my understanding of daikon, I'll call them daikon, okay? I'll mispronounce it. I'm fine with that. But idea of what daikons are supposed to be are these really long baseball bat type radishes, and they're white, and you chop them up and you put them in all kinds of foods. So I decided to grow them in this bed because it has soil a couple feet deep. I know they can get longer than that, but I plan on pulling them before then. Now, one thing I didn't check out was, are these plants going to get tall? See, that's one of the things I just assumed, and probably wrongly so. I assumed the radishes would look like, I mean, the tops would look like my other radishes. So if any of you are growing these, I'd like to know. Or I could look it up, but I'd rather ask you. They don't really have any smell. They do put out a lot of flowers. I noticed that. They're putting out flowers all over the place. Each plant... Oh, what I wanted to know was, is this what they're supposed to look like or not? I don't know if they're... Normally with radishes, if they get this big, they're bolting. And you have bitter radishes. So I don't know if I just didn't grow these right and I should pull them up and get rid of them. Or if this is what they're supposed to look like. I don't want to have to rip them up out of the soil to find out. So I'm asking you. You know, one of the things I noticed is there's a lot of flowers on here. And that's really pretty cool. So if this is what they're supposed to look like, then I'm in business. And I'm going to let these seeds, these flowers, go to seed, and I'm going to collect all the seeds, and then I'll have tons of daikon radish seeds. If not, I guess I'm going to have a lot of compost, because I got to get rid of these things. If they're not growing the way they're supposed to grow, I really would like to get them out of my garden, because they're sucking up valuable nutrients in my soil, and I can use that for other things. And as much as I thought I was doing a really nifty thing by tying up these asparagus, they're not just tall. Look at the height on this thing. They're not just tall, they're wide. I tied these things up against the fence. I thought, well, they're going to stop growing. Well, I mean, growing this way. Well, it turns out that the branches are continuing to grow this way. And they're taking, between them and the monster daikons, I'm really kind of losing my path over here. And then I found out that I have thistles growing in here, and they're kind of purdy, but you don't want to be touching them. This is what a thistle flower looks like. Yeah, they're very closely related. Thistle is very closely related to artichokes, and I'm growing artichokes, so this is a very close relative. Look at how dangerous this thing is. It's basically nature's way of saying, don't touch me. The flowers have spikes on the petals. The stems and leaves have spikes all over the place. It's really a dangerous plant to bump into. This just happened to grow wild in my garden. I have thistle growing everywhere. And there's, you know, you can dig them out by the roots, but you're going to be spending the rest of your life doing that because out here you are, because they just grow nuts all over the place. There's one growing right behind the garden, and I'm going to swing on over here. I'm going to show it to you. Look right over here. This is what they turn out to be like. It's right in front of the little Frady Hole building right there. They turn out really, really tall, and their flowers are beautiful. I'm going to take you over there and show you a close-up of what the flowers look like when they bloom all the way. Look at this. They really do have a nice color. Ouch! Ouch! Oh, that hurt. Okay, well, that was stupid. Now look at this. When they're fully opened up, is that amazing or what? They have slightly pokey things, but these are actually very soft around the perimeter. And what these flowers do is they attract bees. And they're actually quite large. Look at this. Yeah. They attract bees from all over the place. The color and the pollen apparently is really delicious to bees. I have bees coming in all over the place. So I don't discourage these from growing. I don't want them in my beds, so I pluck them out and toss them out. But if they're growing outside the garden, I really don't mind. The dogs don't bump into them because they're not really that stupid, and they're not bothering anything. I can see how you might not want these growing in your yard. the thing is, once they're growing, they're actually, if you don't think of them as a weed and you think of them as just a plant, they're actually quite beautiful. I didn't pinch this off and it's sending out side stalks all over the place. And then it has multiple flowers. It goes for months just blooming and growing. And this plant is about, I'd say, 7 feet tall. And this is early spring, so I really have no idea how tall it's going to end up. That's a thistle. I just wanted to show you one of the many things that are growing around here because it's actually kind of nice. Ah, what the heck. While I got the camera in my hand, let's check out these radish, the daikon flowers. These are what regular radish flowers look like as well. They're kind of delicate. They're kind of a purplish and white. There's all kinds of flowers. And they just keep putting out, they put out multiple heads. See, out of the stem, here's one. And down here, we have another side shoot with more flowers. I grew rat tail radishes once. They are known not for the roots, but for the seed pods. If you take radish seed pods, once these flowers are done and pollinated, when the sun comes up, the pollinators come out. So I'm out early. There are no pollinators. Once the pollinators come out, I stay away from these because there's little bees, wasps, flies, all kinds of buzzy things around here, and I don't want to get in their way. Well, once these go to pod, they'll have these long pods. You can pluck them off there and eat them. They're crunchy and delicious. So that's a second use that you can get for radishes. So if your radishes don't form bulbs and you're kind of disappointed, one way that you can get something out of them, let them grow, let them bolt. And I'm not talking just daikon. Let me swing over here. The same goes for any kind of radish, any kind whatsoever, whether it's globe, French breakfast. See, I'm still eating these. And they're doing pretty good. I still got the radishes down there, but if I want to, I can just let these bolt. They'll put out a stalk and they'll put out flowers. Then they'll put out all kinds of seed pods and I can pluck them and eat them. So if your radishes aren't producing nice, thick, delicious roots, don't worry about it. Let them grow, let them put out the pods, and you can pluck the pods off and you can put them in salads, soups, stir fries, anything that you can put a radish in, you can put the pods in. And they have like a peppery green flavor. And they taste a little bit like a cross between a radish and broccoli, sort of. You got to taste it to find out. Give it a shot. This is my garden wagon. I got this a long time ago, and I never really found a good use for it, so it was in the basement. I finally found a use for it, hauling this big, fat, stinking thing around. It actually took two of us to get this into the cart, Mike and I, and we really strained. We almost pulled something getting this in here because this soil is very heavy. This is just regular soil and compost put in here. Didn't mix in anything else with it. This is supposed to be, I think I might have mentioned this before, this is supposed to be my thornless artichoke. Yeah, and it has thorns, so apparently, well, you know, you order from eBay, you never know what you're going to get. So this was supposed, at least it's an artichoke. That's the best I can say about it. So I don't know what's going to come out of this thing. It might just be thistle. But anyway, I'm growing it in here and I put it in the wagon. That way I can move this wagon anytime I need to get better sun or if I need to mow the grass around it. I really don't know where to put it. I didn't want to grow it in the garden because from what I read, the leaves go way the heck out. So I don't want this taking up all the space in my garden. That's why it's in the wagon, so that I can move it about and it won't be in anybody's way. But I don't water this. I just let it get the water that comes out of the rain. So I haven't watered this one single bit. And what's really weird is it's growing. And it's doing okay. Apparently, artichokes don't require a lot of water. Mostly in the morning, it gets the morning dew on the plant and it drips down. Yeah, we have humid mornings. The morning dew gets this all wet and it drips down on the soil. The soil actually looks a little bit damp. Hey, look at you. Finally, she spent the last half hour up on the porch stairs whining because she wanted to go in while I was out here getting ready to film. And, well, it's because it's morning. You can see that the sun's just coming up. And it's a little cool. It's about, I'd say, 60-something degrees. So it's not cold. But then again, when you're from Las Vegas, you think everything's cold. Look at this. I'm going to zoom in. You got to see this. I'll get back to the artichoke. Look at this big baby. Hey, Tanner. He wants to go inside. There's no way. You're staying out here, you big baby. Anyway, let's get back to what we were talking about. This is the artichoke. I really don't know what to say about this because I don't know how to take care of it. So this is early spring. I don't know if I'm going to get artichokes this year. Some of you have said that it takes 2 years to get artichokes from this. That may be true. I don't know. So I'll keep showing this to you. I wanted to let you know how it's doing because I want to give you updates on all the things in my garden. So I don't know if this is good growth, slow growth, or what. It seems to be doing good. You know what's really weird? My wild thistle seems to grow so much better than this. Weird how when we domesticate something, it never can quite compete with the wild version. I got all kinds of stuff going on. Ah! Another thistle! I got these little buggers growing everywhere. You know, once you got thistle, you always got thistle. This is my little bag thing. Remember I mentioned that? Well, the beans finally sprouted and they're starting to grow out of here. And now they're beginning to go all over the place. A few of you mentioned that this bag may not hold the soil, but it seems to be doing just fine for now. And so I'm just going to let it do what it does. I don't mess with it too much because I figure if this bag is starting to get weak, I don't want to touch it and have it splat all over the place. But for right now, hi. But for right now, I think I'll scratch you. Oh, thank you. Now your tongue tastes like my nose and my nose tastes like your tongue. We are one. Oh, that feels good. Anyway, yeah, it just seems to be doing good. It gets all the water off the roof, and it seems whenever it does rain, but it hasn't rained for quite a long time, so I'm having to water everything by hose. It seems that when I water by hose, everything maintains, but once it rains, everything just seems to go nuts. Little one's right over here. If you're wondering where Rascal is, the rat issue is still going on, and Rascal, hold on, I'll show you. This is what he does. He spends his days, hi. Yeah, I know. You're just trying to help. Right there is a rat hole. And little R, he sits there. Hey, look at you. Yeah. There's a rat hole right there. And Rascal waits. He will sit here for hours, literally hours, waiting for these rats to come out. And they don't come out during the day. So as much as he's quite the little guard dog and the hunter, he really doesn't fare well against these rats. But he's persistent. And these rats have been really doing a number on everything around here. Let me show you. See, they're starting to dig holes, large holes actually. There's one there. There's a large one right there. And they dug underneath here. And let me swing over one more place. They dug the dirt out between the cracks in here. Now that's just outside. Inside the coop, it's a lot worse. I keep my wheelbarrow over here, and what this does is it shades the plastic in the before noon. It doesn't shade the plant. It shades the plastic and keeps the sun from breaking it down and overheating it. That was my solution to keeping these plants cool, and it seems to be doing a job. But I wanted to get back to the rat issue because I mentioned that in the last program, and I wanted to follow up on it because it's an important thing to me. Some folks don't want to hear about it, but this is also a vlog. Let me get out of the sun. I don't know why I'm talking into the sun. Hold, let's go sit over here where the shade is, okay? Ah. Tiki. Ah. Hey there. Yeah. Since Rascal's busy all the time, Tiki keeps me company. Don't worry about Tanner. He keeps me company also, but he likes to come out once the sun's out. He's a heat dog. Once the sun comes out, he's a black dog. You think he wouldn't want to be out in the sun, but he does. He comes right out in the direct sun and just soaks it up, and he's panting up a storm, and then he just flops over and just roasts in the sun. I don't know why. Apparently, it feels good to him, and as long as he's not getting hurt, I really don't mind. Now, I did want to mention just one more thing, and then I won't bug you about it again. With the rat situation, I didn't take this lightly. I had to actually do a lot of thinking about how I wanted to do this because a lot of you know I don't like to hurt creatures. That's just my thing, okay? I don't judge people or fault people for how they want to do things, if they like to hunt, if they want to trap, if they want to kill things. That's their business. It's none of my business because I'm not them. But for me, my personal life here, I don't do that. I just prefer not to because it makes me feel bad. And I wanted to explain that because it's not something I take lightly. There was this movie called Powder a long time ago, many, many years ago. And you can look it up on YouTube too, because there's a very important scene in it. In this movie called Powder, this boy has this ability to make others feel what another creature is feeling. So he met this hunter who took a lot of joy in killing animals. And what he did was he touched a deer that had been shot by this guy and the deer wasn't dead. Then he touched the hunter. And the hunter was able to feel and experience exactly what the deer was going through. The terror and the fear and the pain. And the hunter, it just totally blew his mind and tore him apart, because he didn't think about that. He only thought about his own pleasure. He didn't think about the flip side of the coin. Now, like I said, I'm not throwing dispersions on people who enjoy hunting. I'm just saying, to understand me a little bit better, that's how I am. When I have to kill something, it's just one of those things that I have no control over. I've tried to focus on not getting so involved, but for me, I feel so much pain when I have to do that it's actually unbearable for me. I just can't do it. When it came to getting rid of these rats, when I first noticed them, my first thought was live trapping, you know, to relocate them miles away out into there's a place where we go fishing and nobody lives around there. They'll be just fine. They'll have water, they'll have places to live, and everybody's happy. It's a win-win situation. Rats are creatures. I know people find them disgusting, but they are living, breathing creatures that are just trying to make a buck in this world. You know, they're just trying to get along just like we are. They have families, they have lives, they wake up, they go out, they have to eat. So I didn't want to hurt them. I just didn't want them hurting me and my creatures. When I first saw them, my first thought, like I said, was a live trapping. And I spent a lot of money to go another route as opposed to killing them. Well, that didn't work. Okay, so they didn't go for it. They're very intelligent creatures. My only option after that, and the reason I want to mention this, because you need to understand why I do what I do, and then I think you'll understand me a little bit better, is that I tried that, and my delay, my inaction, my inability to take care of a situation because of my personal feelings cost one of my birds their lives. I went out one morning, and I didn't mention this because I didn't want to, but I want you to understand, okay? I went out to feed the birds, and in the chicken coop, I found one of my hens totally obliterated. There was nothing left but feathers and a skeleton. The rats had swarmed her during the night and murdered her. And I say murdered because that's just the word I use. They killed her. They ate her. They ate every bit of this bird. And I know it wasn't an easy way for her to die. And this is my fault. The buck stops here. That was my fault for not taking care of my animals the way I should. I took a responsibility to take care of these animals to the best of my ability. Now, I feel for the rats, and I feel for the chickens. And no matter what I say, somebody out there is going to take offense. They don't want me killing the rats, and some people are going to be mad at me because I allowed the rats to kill my birds. Either way, I lose in some people's eyes. But this is how I have to live my life. I have to do what I feel is best. I tried to find a balance, and I just couldn't do it. So once they killed the bird, I had to take a decisive steps. And each time, I've been killing the rats. I find them in the traps. It's quick. It's easy. These are metal steel traps that kill them instantly. I didn't want to use glue. I didn't want to use poison. And I wanted to make sure the birds were safe while I did this. And I wanted to make sure that the rats didn't suffer any more than they absolutely had to. So I found the trap that would kill them instantly. And then I get rid of the bodies when I'm done. Each time I have to empty a trap, it really does hurt me. I know that sounds kind of like a wuss, but it does, because I feel how the rat must have felt. You know, you think about what they went through. They're just going about their lives, going and gathering food for their babies, and instantly they're dead. And I also think about the babies. Where's their mother? Where's their father? And what they're going to have to go through. There's nothing I can do about that, and it's unfortunate. But sometimes bad things happen, and I have to deal with it. That's my responsibility as caretaker on the farm. So I wanted to bring that to your attention so that you would understand a little bit about why I do what I do. I don't enjoy it. I don't enjoy talking about it. but I have to do it, and it hurts me. I know it hurts the critters, but it actually hurts me too, physically. I feel that pain, and it's incredible, and I'll be glad when this is over so I don't have to deal with it again. But anyway, I wanted to clear that up. So now that that's all done, if you have any questions or anything, please feel free to ask me, and I don't mind discussing it if you have a real desire to find out more about me. But if you just want to bash me for my decisions on what to do, I'd appreciate it if you just wouldn't do that, because I feel bad enough about it. The rats feel bad enough about it. The chickens feel bad enough about it. Nobody is a winner in this situation. You know, we're all losers in this situation, and I understand that. Anyway, enough of that. There was one request I had from somebody who was interested in the strawberries. So I want to bring you over here to the strawberries, because I made a weird decision about them. Come on over here, and I want to end this on a good note, a very delicious note. Come on over here. This is my strawberry bed, and it's prime picking season. I am right in the middle of the full flush of strawberries. They are producing as fast as I can possibly pick them. For those of you who don't know, this is my lid to the strawberry bed, because I have more birds per square inch than anybody on the planet. And most of them, the blackbirds and the robins, they love strawberries. I know this because I raised a baby robin, and I introduced Christopher, the robin that I raised, to my strawberry bed when I lived in Minnesota. I was taking him for her for a walk. This is a robin that I raised from an egg. I hatched it, raised it, and then released it back into the wild. Anyway, I took Christopher to my strawberry patch, and we were hunting worms, and Christopher found a strawberry. And Christopher ran over there, grabbed it, and started tugging like crazy until she got it off the plant. And I went to go grab it from her, and she went running with the strawberry. So that's how I found out that robins love strawberries. So the robins will come in and peck these. So I have to keep them protected if I want some for myself. Well, it is prime picking season for strawberries, and they are all over the place. There's red strawberries, there's non-red strawberries, just everywhere you look. See, they're in every stage, from white and green to pinkish, then orange, and then red. And when you pick strawberries, my advice is to not yank on them, because you can pull a lot of the plant out, or the whole stem. Just take your finger, put it behind the strawberry, take your thumb, and just snap it like that. You'll get the strawberry with the stem. And these are the... Okay, I'm not even going to try and pronounce it, because I keep forgetting how to. I'm just going to put the name right here, okay? This is the type of strawberry we're talking about. You pronounce it any way you want. They're not known for being the biggest strawberry. They're not known... Well, see, that's the thing about strawberries. Let me back you up, and then I'll tell you about these strawberries. The smell. In the morning, you walk by here, and you can smell the fragrance of these strawberries coming out of the garden. It's incredible. And that's one of the things. When you look up this strawberry, that's one of the things that you're going to find out, is that they're not the, you know, they're not the world's largest strawberry. Not at all. And, hey, see? Yeah. Yeah, this is kind of good, huh? Yeah, it does. Not as good as the radish, but it's pretty darn good. They have a wonderful fragrance. That is one of the things. They have more smell than any other strawberry I've ever heard of. And they're not the largest. They're not the sweetest. Now, that's the thing. That's what I wanted to bring to your attention. When you're looking for the best strawberry to grow, it's all a relative thing. It's like asking somebody, what's the best lettuce to grow? It depends on what you like. Some people like head lettuce. Some people like romaine, green leaf, butter crunch. It's all a personal preference. Now, also sweetness. Some people think certain strawberries are sweet. Some people don't. It's all in your taste buds. That's the thing. We have these taste buds that are very individual. Now, I read up on strawberries before I got these. I wanted to find the best strawberry I possibly could. I was growing something called Gurney Giant or something like that. I'm not really quite sure what it was called. It was from Gurney's online nursery. You can buy things, and they send you the catalog, you know. Well, I ordered strawberries years ago, and I really wasn't that happy with them. So I wanted to find something to take their place. These are the ones that I decided on, because all the reviews, everybody was saying, oh, they're delicious. They're the best strawberry in the world. I've grown these. This is my second or third year now. And I'm going to give you my honest appraisal of these. They're good, but I don't find them sweet. I've let them ripen to blood red. I mean, the most beautiful dark red, which means perfectly ripe, soft to the touch, fragrant. I bite into them and I find a tartness to them. Now, that tartness tells me that these would be absolutely perfect. That means pectin. Now, whenever something's tart, that's pectin. Now, these would be absolutely perfect for strawberry jam, strawberry pie, all kinds of strawberry things that you want to make. These would be perfect for that. I got to say that. But for fresh eating, I don't much care for them. No, they're definitely not my thing. Because when I bite into a strawberry, when I was a kid, I have a story about strawberries, but I'm not going to bore you with it because it's going to be in my book. See, everything I grow here is for a reason, and it relates back to something in my past. Everything that you see, everything in my programs has a tie to my past, and that's what's going to be in the book. You're going to understand why I do what I do, and when you read those things, and then you tune back in on the programs, you're going to go, I know why he's doing that. I remember that. It's going to make so much sense. It's going to be fun, and we're going to communicate on such a great level. But back to the strawberries. When I was a kid, I fell in love with strawberries because I stole one from an old woman. And I raided her garden. I was a little thug, a little tiny thug. I stole a strawberry, went running away with it, put it in my mouth. It was the best thing on the planet. And I, right then and there, I thought, I want these things. I want to grow these things. And I finally did. I have yet to find one that hits my taste buds like they did back then. The ones at the store, they're huge. They look like apples, but they're dry and they're hard and they're just not right. But they're grown for looks and saleability. They'll stay on the shelves a long time. These ones don't strike me. The gurney ones, ooh, dandelion. The gurney ones, I don't much care for those. So I'm going to just keep going and trying different strawberries. At the end of this season, I'm taking these strawberries up and I'm going to just plant them and let them grow wild all over the property, and that way the wildlife can eat these things and I don't have to deal with them. Yes, I'm going to dig up the entire strawberry patch, replant them all over the place, and they will grow wild all over the place. I'm going to replant them, mix up some more compost on this, and I'm going to order new strawberry plants for next spring and start all over again. I know that sounds ridiculous, but that's just what I want to do because it's all about what I want to eat. And if I don't want to eat these and I don't feel good about these, then why am I even doing it? So I'm not really that fond of these. The chickens, they love these. So what I've been doing is just picking them and feeding them to the chickens. Yes. I've been feeding my strawberries to the chickens. Anyway, that's my appraisal of these strawberries. I hope you guys enjoyed the stuff I had to ramble on about today. And if you have any questions or concerns, please post them in the comment section below. I am always here. And I want to tell you something. I read every single comment. So if you post a comment just saying hi or nice video, no matter what you have to say, I see it. So don't ever think that I'm not paying attention to what you have to say. If you have something that you want to discuss, I'm always there to discuss it with you. If you just want to say hi, I'm there hitting the like button on your hi. And thanks for joining me on the farm. I really do appreciate it. I'll see you next week. Have a great day, everybody. Tiki. Tiki. Want to smell another strawberry? Can I fool you twice? Huh? I can fool you twice. That's why I love you so much. Yes, that's why I love my little tiki. Hey, birds. Hip. 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 Hey, birds. Hip. Yeah. Look what I got. Yeah. You don't even like strawberries. Don't even act like you do. Hey, look. See? If you have chickens and you have strawberries that you can't stand, turkeys like them. They eat them whole. You don't like strawberries. You just want to eat it because everybody else wants to eat it. Hey, sweetie. You know, you can chew these things. The chickens like them when I take a bite out of it first. And that way, yeah, see? Squeeze it a little bit. Toss. Delicious. And it's really good for them. They're high in vitamins. Well, it looks like the turkey's the only one that's going to be getting these. Yay, now my fingers are red. You just want everything everybody else wants. You little pig with horns, you. Yeah, daddy loves you, pig with horns.